flowers the pretty things, though?
Aren't flowers the pretty things, Skippy?
They sure are, Mom. But if it's nice flowers you're wanting, I was at a place yesterday across the tracks and, maybe it was on this side. Anyway, it was yesterday.
Have you been across the tracks again to Shantytown?
Of course, there's plenty of pretty buds on this side. A kid was telling me...
You heard my question, Skippy.
Pa?
Did you go across the tracks yesterday?
You mean yesterday?
Exactly.
You mean the tracks... down by the railroad tracks?
I want you to answer yes or no.
Who told you?
Hello and welcome to Comic Book Movie Oblivion, the podcast about feature films based on comic books and comic strips that people have stopped talking about. We are your hosts, Jordan and Kumar, that's me.
And me.
And this week we are talking about Skippy from 1931, based on the comic strip by Percy Crosby from 1923, which began in 1923 and ran in Life magazine.
At least some of the time, until 1945, I think.
Yes, and then, so it was syndicated, so I think Life was weekly, don't quote me on that, but it was syndicated out to newspapers, so they would have had equivalent of something like Sunday pages, color
sure.
Sunday pages.
Because it was color strip.
Yes, but there were no dailies, as far as I know. So, what can we say about Skippy? Well, it's... almost exactly what you'd expect from 1923
sure.
comic about little kids. Because it's really very... Our gang started in 1922, the Hal Roach
That's
shorts,
the Little Rascals.
The Little Rascals, yeah. A.K.A. the Little Rascals.
Yeah, so I would know of them as the Little Rascals.
Yeah, even in the 80s, we had a cartoon called the Little Rascals. It was an 80s cartoon. So I only knew them as the Little Rascals. And but they were based on these... I guess, weekly titled Our Gang shorts by Hal Roach, which went on for years and years, and were, I think there were hundreds of them. And they would swap out kids and stuff as they went on. But it's kind of that thing, so... But there are certain... Or maybe it's not what I expect, but what I've come to expect because of the language that Skippy set down for these things. So, for example, the picket fences that seem to be in the background all the time,
yeah.
and these little tufts of grass, and those kinds of things are like in... like Ernie Bushmiller's Nancy constantly.
Right.
And they were also very, very strong influence on Charles Schulz's
Absolutely.
Peanuts.
Yes,
And
sure.
especially if you
for
look
sure.
at the very first Peanuts strip where the kids are sitting on the curb, I mean, it's not, it's an angle you'd never see from Percy Crosby. And in fact, Charles Schulz stopped doing those kinds of 45 degree angles of kids walking up the street. But just them sitting on the curb or whatever. Just hanging out on the street is the kind of thing that you associate with kid strips. But I guess it must. Maybe he was the first to. But again, I also think of Tom Sawyer, which has had all that stuff about painting fences,
of course.
That was 1870.
Yeah, way back in the 19th century.
Seven or six or something like that.
So
76. Yeah.
So yeah. So Percy Shelby was born in the 19th century,
yes.
1891. So a whole generation older, even than Al Capp.
Yes.
And when I, as you say, when I sat down and, now I sat down and read the comics before I knew anything about him
yep.
or anything about what Skippy was, except what you said at the end of last week's episode.
Okay.
So I sat down and I read it and it's like you said, it's exactly what you'd expect from a comic
yes.
in 1923.
Yeah.
You know, it's just so, it feels so hokey and the art is... It looks like, they look like Hallmark cards, you know, like this kind of washed out, chintzy art. Wait. Okay, I can see your grimace, but please, I'm coming. I do have a point. And and the humor is so lame. You know, like there'll be 12 panels to set up some sort of lame gag.
Yeah,
something like that.
I would say, I found this thing online,
yep.
which is like a collection of like 50 Skippy strips, 50
yep.
or so.
Yeah.
I had two gut laughs probably.
I didn't going laugh through at them. All. I'm afraid I like the humor, like it's just really like the lamest punchline. Yeah, I could. The only trouble is the only one I can remember is the asbestos one. Okay, and that's exceptional. That one. Okay. So this one, speaking of dating things.
Because sometimes I didn't understand. Right. I didn't understand what the kids were saying.
Yeah.
It was like hard to make out at times. But anyway,
if you just had to think of something where it completely different from Little Abner, say, where Little Abner, I think, very readable for a modern audience.
Yeah.
Very kind of edgy humor.
Yeah.
Funny, dealing with stereotypes, stuff like that. You know, like the Skippy's so wholesome. It's about a little boy.
Yeah.
So little boy in the 1920s, he wears a high collar, a
red coat,
a necktie, yeah, and a floppy hat.
Yeah.
And it'll be just the average strip. It'll be about him comically misunderstanding something, perhaps, or playing a trick on somebody, Tom Sawyer style.
Yes.
Or
there's some pranks.
So he's mischievous.
Which I think was like when the slingshot. I mean, there's slingshot gags in here, and immediately I went to Dennis the Menace.
Okay.
I felt that was...
Is Dennis the Menace contemporaneous?
No, it's much later, but right. I feel like there was an influence. I feel like there's a chain.
Yes. Oh, okay.
And also, you know, Bill Watterson, who did Calvin and Hobbes, said he was not influenced by Skippy.
Okay.
But he was influenced by Peanuts.
Yeah.
And so there's definitely a parentage there, and I...
Yes. This is the point I'm coming to, which you've anticipated. So, yeah, okay, so the... I'll come back to the asbestos thing.
Okay.
But basically, this film, it feels so hokey and...
The comic.
Yeah. So hokey and dated and moldy oldie and your great-great-grandparents' idea of what's funny.
Yeah.
And now, there's a phenomenon. There's probably a proper name for it, but all that comes to mind is what it's labeled on... website, very much friend of the show, TV Tropes.
Okay.
On TV Tropes, it's called Seinfeld is Unfunny.
Okay.
And it is essentially the idea that a thing that is copied over and over and over starts to seem unoriginal.
Right.
And it refers to how people...
The original seems unoriginal.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
So it's like how people go back to Seinfeld, or young people who didn't watch Seinfeld when it came out, go back to it and like, what are all these grandparents talking... What are all these old boomers talking about? Middle-aged men.
Yes.
What are they saying? It's just like XYZ. You know, there's nothing particularly funny or clever or edgy about this. But the thing is, Seinfeld did it first.
Right.
And was an incredible phenomenon. So what happened was, after I read these comics and rolled my eyes and thought, it's so lame, it's so boring, it's so of its time, then I went onto the Wikipedia website and I looked at the Wikipedia articles about it, and they all praise it to the heavens. Mm-hmm. Say, oh man, Percy Shelley... the first guy to do this.
Yeah.
The first guy to draw in this way.
Yeah.
The first guy to really kind of explore the potential of the strip to tell a single kind of gag.
Yep.
From start to finish.
Yep.
Yeah. And so, you know, as you said, like, this is a strip that's really, really, really influential.
Yeah.
Like Seminal. You said, Peanut. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
and it's just because we've seen it, like we've read it. Certainly, you read Peanuts, we know, or Garfield,
yeah,
or anything like that. That's his legacy that we're kind of interacting with there.
Yes,
and so of course when we go back and read it, and it's like the Hallmark card art, like it's so washed out, and like something your grandparents would have up in a print in their house, and the jokes are so lame.
I actually think that I'm going to say that I think the line work is actually really good.
Okay, I'm less of an art guy than you are.
He's found a very compact, tight way of drawing these things with he's got a very fine pen line.
Right.
Which I liked. Now, as I said, I only found like a couple of jokes funny. Like one was where he's complaining that Skippy's complaining about he's bored today. And then his friend runs past him at top speed, and he's like, what's going on? He said, I broke a window. And then he's like, oh, I'm going to run too. And he starts running at top speed. He's like, why am I running? I didn't break the window. And he stops, and then the cop walks up right behind him and picks him up by the collar.
Perfect. That's a really good example. Okay, so yeah, it's mildly amusing, but that's a perfect example of the kind of joke the strip tells.
Well, no, you know, I don't think it's perfect, because I think that one's better than any of the others.
But
I don't
me,
think it's a perfect example.
Okay,
I think it's an exceptional example.
I got it. Yeah, right, okay, I got it. So, it's like you said, but I mean, think of that. If you told a gag, if I was sitting with you in a pub or something, and I told you a gag where the punchline was, He was running away, too.
Wait a second. This is not a... That's a 100% violation of the point of comics. It's sure. You're not telling the joke in prose. You've got the drawings. That's the whole point of it.
Okay, sure. Fair enough. But it's just like... It's a pretty lame joke where the punchline is the cop hauls him up because he was running away as well. And you have like 4 or 5 panels setting it up. But I'll tell you, the one that made me laugh was the asbestos one, and it made me laugh for the wrong reasons.
Okay.
So what happened was Skippy and one of his friends are going to the beach, and they're going to light a fire on the beach.
Okay.
And the friend says, I need some paper to light the fire with.
Okay.
And Skippy says, here's some paper, and gives it to him.
Okay.
And the kid's trying to light it. It doesn't light. He's like, hey, Skippy, what gives? This paper won't light. And then Skippy, walking away, says, that's because it's asbestos.
I'm trying to figure out why I didn't remember this one. I found that hilarious.
It's very early on. I found that hilarious, of course, because the idea of children playing with asbestos
right.
is hilarious. Because, of course, it's now considered such a horrifically dangerous substance to interact with.
Yeah.
But, of course, back in the day when this was written... asbestos was seen as an incredibly useful material.
Also would say I think his target audience was the kids that were the same age as Skippy.
You think so? I think it was probably in Life magazine. I don't know.
Maybe it's hard to imagine he's pitching to a Life magazine audience. I don't know. Is it possible?
I feel like these
Are the rest of the features
It's different time, right? I mean. What seems to us hackneyed, to them perhaps seemed like it was a really kind of the idea of a single strip telling a joke from start to finish. Presumably, really, it's like watching Charlie Chaplin nowadays. Like Charlie Chaplin's really hard to laugh at when you watch it because the soap.
I disagree 100%.
Okay, of course. 100%.
Have you seen City Lights?
Of course, that movie's genius. Of course, you would say that. Yes, of course he's a genius, but it's just not as.
I laughed the whole way through those movies. Oh. All the Harold Lloyd movies.
You would say that. All right, I'm pivoting.
No, there's no way I would say like a Charlie Chaplin or Harold Lloyd was...
I would say a big part of... I brought up Charlie Chaplin for a reason, which I'll come back to later. But I would say a big part of it of its appeal would have been, I think, the novelty.
Yes.
Because, it's really... The jokes really feel lame. They feel super
lame. I think
compared to Little Abner, which is almost contemporaneous, right? Only about 10 years later.
Yeah.
And Little Abner reading Little Abner 80 years later, you find it's funny. Like it's really funny.
Yes.
And you couldn't. I challenge you to find anyone over 5 years of age that thinks Skippy is the height of comedy.
No, I agree with that. And the other thing about it is I think because Our Gang had started in 1922, I think if Percy Crosby hadn't done Skippy, somebody would have done something similar because the film and comics were developing at the same time and they were feeding off each other.
Right.
So I think somebody would have said, well, let's try to do something like Our Gang, but in comics form, and would have tried to work out how to do it in one page or a Sunday Super Day issue.
Percy was the guy that did it, and as I said, I did think he drew it well. Percy Crosby was the guy that did it. We should talk a bit about him, because he's an interesting character.
Maybe more interesting than the strip in some ways.
I would say so. I completely agree.
So all the information about him is contradictory, so...
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, I'd never read a Skippy strip before today. But I would say, if you said Skippy to me before, I would have immediately thought of Skippy Peanut Butter.
Okay.
So, which I don't think we even get in Canada. I think it's an American brand. I don't think it's available. But somehow I know about Skippy Peanut Butter.
Okay.
So what happened was... So Percy Crosby was a licensing fiend. Apparently he licensed everything. He licensed Skippy out everywhere. He's making money on it. Great. I love it when cartoonists make money, as I've said before on this show.
He really made money.
He made a lot of money. So, but he somehow did not get around to doing peanut butter, and this other company made a peanut butter, and they called it Skippy, and they had it on the front, image of the, on the label was like of a fence, and the logo was almost like the Skippy logo.
Yeah. Yes, it's absolutely a cash in on.
Yes, absolutely. On that's it.
Yeah.
So then, okay, now we get 60, 70 years of back and forth suing each other. So basically, initially he sues them for infringement of his name, and the court says, well, you don't have a peanut butter and it's not going to be confused with the comic strip or something. I might be getting this wrong because I can't remember, because the court always goes back and forth on whether it's a violation or not. Eventually, he just gives up. He's like, well, fine, because I guess it was exclusive to California at the time.
He had other problems, too, because he was in litigation with the IRS.
Well, okay, so, this is something we didn't talk about with before we move on from the Skippy strip. So, and it actually ties into him. So, there's only one continuity in the history of Skippy, and apparently it was 3 months of Skippy versus Al Capone.
Right.
And this was collected into a book in 2011 called Skippy versus the Mob. I challenge anyone on earth to find a copy of this book. It's gone.
Right. Anywhere. Oh, really?
Okay. Can't even find the strips were reprinted in some handsome, like, 4-volume hardcovers, so they're probably
within the last 10 years, they've been, or 10 to 15 years, they've been reprinted. And I think that has been pushed by his daughter.
Yes.
Who runs, among other things, she runs Skippy Inc.
Yes.
And she's his legal, like, she's his heir, so she controls the trademark of Skippy.
Yeah.
And she runs a website called Skippy.com.
Yeah.
And I invite you to go and check out Skippy.com because it is crazy.
We have to backtrack.
Right, we absolutely need to backtrack.
Before we get to that, the wildness of Skippy.com. So, he gives up on that, and then, he did this strip called about Skippy versus Al Capone. This is while Al Capone was alive, and my impression is that, and something that I read, that Percy Crosby was offended by the kind of fame, the notoriety that people were talking about him, talking about Capone like a celebrity.
Like Dick Tracy, the artist Dick Tracy, right? He also didn't like Al Capone.
Yes,
and Big Boy was originally an Al Capone.
Yes. So, now, what happened to Percy Crosby at the end was that he was institutionalized.
Right, okay. Story's ping-ponging all over the place.
Well, no, we have to ping-pong. That's the only way to tell is back and forth. So what happened, we'll talk about why he's institutionalized, but he was, so there was a suicide attempt. Okay, his mother died, he attempted suicide, he was diagnosed as paranoid schizophrenic and delusional. And then for the rest of his life, the last 16 years of his life, he was in this institution. He never saw his children again.
No.
He was married 3 times, but he never saw his kids again.
Kids were mostly from the second marriage.
And he died on his 73rd birthday in the institution. Apparently, he had gone to... He was doing watercolors and inks of the inmates over those years. And I think most of that artwork is gone, as far as I know. Now, here's where we rewind. So, some people allege, maybe his daughter as well as one of them, I'm sure she's one of them, that probably would allege, that he was misdiagnosed.
Yes.
And it was all put on by the mob, who were angry at him, and they pulled these strings to get him investigated by the FBI and be audited by the IRS, and also somehow the mob got him thrown into this institution.
Not just the mob.
Yeah.
But the mob, yes. And this is, so his enemies are multitudinous.
Yes. Oh, because he was also very anti-Roosevelt.
He was very anti-Roosevelt.
Self-publishing books. He was self-publishing like 8 different books that were anti-communist as well.
Yes.
Even though initially, as a teenager, he had worked at a socialist newspaper.
He had,
Maybe he wasn't there for the politics. He was just trying to draw cartoons. Apparently, he was fired from a few different places or whatever. But
it's tough to say. But yeah, he was... So, on Skippy.com, the mob, FDR, apparently FDR was enraged, personally enraged by comics that he wrote, critical of his attempt to pack the Supreme Court in the night. Anyway, it doesn't matter. And that prompted along with the mob, and finally, the final pillar of this tripod of iniquity that was persecuting Percy Shelby was...
Percy Crosby, not Percy Crosby. Shelley.
Percy Shelley. If you Google Percy Crosby, you get like...
Percy Bysshe anyway. Shelley?
Yeah, you get Percy Bysshe Shelley. With Percy Crosby is the peanut butter lobby.
Right. Oh, big peanut butter.
Big peanut butter.
Right.
So because, you know, Skippy Peanut Butter has made so much money out of selling off of the Skippy trademark. This is...
Yes, but so they no longer have the fence or anything on their labels.
Yep, it doesn't matter.
None of those initial connections, the rip-off connections are there. Anyway, go ahead.
But that's it. You know, it was this nefarious triumvirate almost that had Percy Crosby institutionalized and took away his liberty. Like, the website uses this very emotive language.
Right.
First of all, it talks about him as a genius, a fearless defender of liberty, a tireless campaigner for justice.
Right.
And whose liberty was cruelly taken from him by nefarious interests that were profiting off of his art, off of his work.
Right.
And at every attempt to try and, you know, extricate him from those circumstances were foiled by, you know, like, they literally use evocative phrasing like big peanut butter or... you know, like the carbohydrate lobby, and you know, like just crazy stuff. Yeah. The truth, as you said, you look. I didn't spend a lot of time on Percy Shelby. I mostly read up about Jackie Cooper, the actor in the film.
Okay,
but if you look him up, there you get contrasts. Right. So the Wikipedia article is pretty critical.
Right.
It essentially says that as time went on, something like his fame went to his head, and he started insisting that publications of his comic needed to be paired with his political essays.
Right.
So he sort of kind of started to go off. I can't find any examples of what exactly he thought. Mm. I just know that he was anti-communist and anti-Roosevelt and anti-Russian.
Right.
So it sounds like pretty right-wing nuttery.
Right.
But, you know, but I couldn't find any examples of what would be called his... He published a book called A Cartoonist's Philosophy, apparently, right. in 1931, I think, the same year the film came out. But I didn't have time to find a copy of it, or even find a synopsis.
Good luck, yeah.
Yeah. Self-published under his Freedom Press.
Freedom Press, what a name. It's so obvious.
It sounds... It could be today, couldn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
His beliefs seem to plug right into kind of Trumpy kind of things, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But, and he also, it's noted as well that his works also, he used to be able to keep those things separate, those spheres separate, his political musings, his comic, but as time went on, they start to bleed into one another.
Right.
And the comic, unlike Little Abner, which lasted for 50 years, this people got tired of Skippy when Skippy started stopped being those gentle gags that we read and became polemics.
I would love to read those strips because I just don't know how he slotted them into the format he was using. It's baffling to me.
That's why I'm disappointed that I couldn't find out more about it in the time we had available.
Yeah, it's very hard to find this stuff online.
I'd love to see what was considered extreme in the 1940s.
Yeah, but I mean, I would like to. I like any political angle to me would be interesting to read as in comic strip form. But also the thing about at some point she gave up suing them. She said she conceded to them. But then she turned around and was like, actually, I'm going to sue them again. And also, at one point, apparently, she was going after people on eBay selling Skippy used stuff. I don't know.
She seems really a bit unhinged. But to return to Shelby's life story.
Yes.
He also struggled with alcohol.
Crosby.
Why did I say Shelby again? That's your fault.
You went to Shelby. You went from Shelley to Shelby. Yeah.
With Crosby's life story, he struggled with alcohol.
Yes.
Right.
He was on and off. So on he was off. Apparently off
sober
for seven
years. When I think he was most productive with the comic during those 7 years.
Right. Okay.
One of the reasons why Skippy came to an end in the mid 1940s was that he was struggling with alcoholism and wasn't as productive.
Yes.
And alcoholism seems to have played a big role in his mental decline.
Sure.
So this is straight from Wikipedia.
Yeah.
They have this straightforward narrative.
Yeah.
became...
Whereas another website said the suicide was alleged. Alleged suicide.
Skippy.com says alleged.
Okay.
The police found no evidence of a weapon. Like, he tried to slit his wrists when his mother died.
Okay.
And then, it, very interesting choice. Of, so they, the website implies that it was set up.
That somebody tried to murder him?
Either by the mob.
Yeah, crazy.
It was set up by the mob to have him institutionalized.
Right.
So his third, he married his third wife, who was a nurse and a dietitian, I believe, at around this point, shortly before he was institutionalized. Because, okay, as you said, he would go on benders. His second wife, with whom he had four children, one of whom is the one that runs the website, left him in the middle of it, like, just left.
Okay.
He went on a bender, came home, she wasn't there.
Okay.
He had a breakdown, his mother died, he attempted suicide, he was essentially committed.
Yeah.
And his third wife didn't have the wherewithal to mount any kind of legal challenge to his institutionalization.
Right.
She wasn't particularly wealthy. She had her own health issues with diabetes, okay, apparently. And so he, perhaps, we just don't know, right? It's certainly not, he wasn't the victim of some kind of conspiracy. I think it's pretty clear that he had serious kind of
mental health issues.
Mental health issues.
Yeah.
Precisely. But there is something very sad that he was in an institution for 16 years, apparently still trying to work,
mm-hmm,
still writing letters,
mm-hmm,
but the letters, because he was in what was essentially an asylum in the, you know, 50s, you know, none of his letters, you know, would leave the place.
Right.
The staff would just confiscate them.
Right.
Everything was subject... He had no rights. Everything was subject to the oversight that he was under in this facility.
Right.
So it's a sad story, absolutely. But was he put there by the mob? I doubt it very much. I think he was put there by a unfair kind of... or an uncaring system that was typical of the time.
Right. Right.
But, oh man.
Okay, well, where do we go from there?
Like you said, as far as I know, the legal case against Skippy Peanut Butter, which his heirs blame for all their woes, and presumably for the reason for which they aren't millionaires, on the back of the Skippy brand, it's still, you go to the page, and a prominent link is click on this link to sign the petition to have Skippy Peanut Butter stop trading under that name.
Right. That'll never happen.
No.
I have to say, there's an interesting thing about as far as the peanut butter goes, there's an interesting continuity with the licensing in the terms of the amount of licensing that Percy Crosby did, and then Charles Schulz, who kind of picked up the reins of Kids Comic and, you know, made the best of them all, probably.
Hmm.
And he licensed like crazy.
Yes.
As well. And I think he was doing especially weird stuff that was not in keeping with the strip. But then you get to Bill Watterson and Calvin Hobbes, and he... Zero. Absolute zero. Refused. 100%. The only thing that ever came out was... And it was the bane of his existence, was those bootleg stickers of Calvin peeing, which you would see on the back of trucks. And he hated those, and he never... So obviously, bootleg, because he never... So somehow, in that, as those generations went down, there was a complete shift.
Well, allegedly, Percy Crosby didn't like the film, the 1931 film.
Okay.
He didn't like it, but was contractually obliged to sign on to the sequel.
Okay.
Which is called Suki.
Yes, yes.
But yeah, another thing, and that might be a good segue to start talking about the film.
Yeah, I don't know if I had anything else to say about the comic, except I mentioned the slingshots, the pranks, stealing fruit, that's another thing that you see in kids.
Right.
Kids.
They steal fruit in the film too, don't they?
And also, sleep, him. There was a strip where he's unable to sleep before a baseball game, which really was a long number of strips in Peanuts, was where Charlie Brown couldn't sleep before the baseball. And also, failing miserably at the baseball game is something that happens in one of these strips, and happens in Peanuts all the time.
Yeah.
And also, there's one where he's trying to kick a football, and he's like stumbling around, and he can't kick it. And that really reminded me of Lucy pulling the football away from Charlie Brown.
Yeah. I think this is a huge influence on Peanuts.
Yeah.
Huge influence.
All right, so 1931, we get this movie. Yes. Directed by Norman Taurog.
Yes.
Don't know who that is.
Well.
He was the uncle of Jackie Cooper.
Correct.
And he was nominated for Best Director for this movie.
Not only nominated, he won.
He did win.
He won?
Yes, he did win.
So this is the Academy Award?
Yes. It was a fourth or fifth Academy Awards. Jackie Cooper was nominated for Best Actor. He was 9 years old. And he's the... still
eight,
the,
I believe.
Okay, still
maybe
the youngest.
Nine when he was nominated.
Yeah, so he's still the youngest... ever
nominee for best
actor.
Leading actor, yeah.
Actually, even Norman, the Taurog director, was the youngest director until
La La Land.
La La Land.
That's right. He was 32 years of age when he won Best Director.
Right.
For this film in 1931,
And it was nominated for Best Picture.
It was.
And lost to some movie I've never heard of.
It was the only comic-based movie to be nominated for an Academy Award. For
until,
almost 100
until
years
Black
until
Panther?
Black Panther. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Almost 100 years.
Okay. Interesting. Jackie Cooper, as we said, was age 9, but 50 years later he would play Perry White in
the Superman
pick
that
up. Movies.
I was wondering.
Of course. I recognize his face. I was like, wait a second, Jackie Cooper. I was like, hi, I've seen this man's name 3,000 times, but on what? And then I saw his face and I was like, Somehow, it didn't click immediately, but then it was like, oh my God, it's Perry White.
Yep. Yes, in the Superman film. So an appropriate connection.
But also the kid who played Suki, whose name was something Coogan or
Robert
something.
Robert Coogan.
He was in a few of the Joe Palooka movies. So
he was as an adult, yeah.
Yeah. So Joe Palooka was a boxing comic. And they made like 12 or they made a bunch of shorts and they made like 12 feature movies, really low budget movies based on Joe Palooka.
Yes.
And, this other lead in this movie was in those, which
yes.
reminds me, one of the reasons, the things, this is probably one of the earliest features we're going to cover. Because
they don't go much earlier than this.
No, there are some that are earlier in this, but they're, what I found
silent
is that
films.
They're, they're silent. That I wouldn't rule it out because they're silent, but they're none of them are longer than 70, 75 minutes.
Okay.
They're barely feature length. They're almost TV length. And there was one about a flying ace. I can't remember what it was called, but they did four features in 1 year, but those features are an hour long.
Okay.
So I'm like, well, this is almost, you can see there's a clear shift when TV happens. Suddenly the movies start going to 90 minutes or 2 hours. But before that, like a movie is like 60, 65 minutes.
Right.
So well, I'm kind of like,
this one's 90 minutes.
This one is 85.
Okay.
So it's kind of, yeah, you know what I mean?
Thanks for that splitting that hair.
Well, the hair, I actually think that the first thing that's longer, that's actually 90 or longer is Prince Valiant.
In
terms of
the
comics,
50s?
Yeah.
Oh, in terms of comics.
In terms of comic adaptations.
Sure, sure.
I think everything before is pretty short, except for this one, which is this is the closest one I could find that was like close to what we think of as feature length.
So you're referring here to your list, your spreadsheet.
Yes, the list of all the movies we're going to eventually cover on this show.
Yes.
And there are some earlier in this, but they're like 60, 70 minutes. I'm like, is that even a movie
by our
current standards?
This is really the earliest thing that approaches feature length.
Yes.
That really is feature length, I mean, all things considered.
Yeah.
And that's also a talkie. So this came out in 1931.
Jazz Singer came out in 27,
which
is, I think, the first feature-length talkie.
Right. That sounds about right. Around 1927, 1928, that's what I think. Yes. So we're talking about an era when films had sound for less than 5 years.
Yes, that's right.
And it's...
And I think that's important because I think it puts... I think the amount of fast talking in this movie... Like, they are like, we're using this sound. Like, these kids are going to talk.
This movie is remarkable, really. You're right. There's a lot of dialogue in it.
Yeah.
A lot. And I think part of that is because Skippy, obviously, in the comic, like, there's a lot of talking. Like, the jokes are delivered in dialogue.
Yeah.
So Skippy is humorous.
Yes.
And the humor comes... It's not physical humor. He doesn't do physical comedy. It's not Buster Keaton or something like that, right? He's primarily delivering funny lines.
Yes.
But I think it's pretty remarkable how watchable this film is, considering the era.
I loved this movie. I loved it. I laughed beginning to end. I thought that it was just, it's nonstop gags. It's precocious kids. The actors are, I was like, when I saw that they had nominated this 9-year-old in 1931 for Best Actor, I was like, okay, it's not going to be that great. It's going to be one of those Academy mistakes. And the performances are actually amazing. I think Suki, actually, the kid, that Coogan kid, is really special in this
movie. That reminds me of what I wanted to bring up.
Yeah.
Okay, so Robert Coogan played Suki.
Yeah.
He's pretty good. I don't think he's good as Jackie Cooper.
Okay.
I thought, yeah, he just doesn't have... Jackie Cooper's really got the stuff.
Jackie Cooper had been in Our Gang.
Yes.
29 to 31.
Yes, he had. Yes.
So he was already kind of in this zone.
Yes. He sure can act, and he can cry on cue.
They called
him.
Yeah.
They called him Bucket of Tears. And in fact, in all of his roles after this is what in all of his roles after this,
yeah,
he would always cry because you couldn't have Jackie Cooper in a film
really
without him crying.
Oh, we never did pause the podcast because I would have actually paused it.
Yeah, you reckon?
Oh, yeah, because I was very shocked by the turn. It's too late to pause the podcast now. But I did not expect what happened.
Well, we can do it right now. Kumar is saying right now, you should stop
pause,
now.
Yeah, pause now, yeah.
And you should go
and
watch
come back and listen to the rest of the episode.
Absolutely.
So,
sorry, but to finish that anecdote, now that they've paused and come back, to finish my anecdote about Robert Coogan, who plays Suki.
Yeah.
I was watching this and I thought, this kid looks really familiar.
Okay.
Which is absurd, considering this is a movie that came out in the 30s.
Yeah.
His older brother was Jackie Cooper, who was the biggest child star of the 20s, and was in The Kid.
No, wait, rewind. It's not Jackie Cooper. Jackie Cooper is Skippy.
Jackie Coogan.
Okay.
Sorry, Jackie Coogan. So not Jackie Cooper, obviously, that's
okay.
That's Skippy. Yeah. Jackie Coogan.
Okay.
Who was the biggest child star of the 20s. And was the kid in the Charlie Chaplin film, The Kid.
Okay. Wow.
But this is his younger brother playing Suki.
Yes. Right. Okay. So he's like the Clint Howard. Because he's kind of doing the B-movies the rest of his career and then dies at 43. Clint Howard's alive and well, and he's a great actor. So never mind, I said that.
Right.
Should
we go into the plot?
Yeah, so first of all, I want to describe a little bit about the production here, because I kind of understand why he got nominated for Best Director at the time. So most of the interiors are three-wall interiors, so we don't get a fourth wall. There's still a little bit of vaudeville tradition in here, I think, where these cameras are all set up on one side, so they're just shooting the actors, and you never see that fourth wall. When they go outside, the exteriors are all exteriors.
Yeah.
And, so we can get to the plot. So, in this, Skippy is the son of a doctor, which I don't know if that's the case in comic because we didn't read enough of the comics and it was never discussed in the 50 strips we read. Although, we do know his dad, I think he's a smart guy because there's one strip where he loans a book to someone or he borrows a book and Skippy has to return the book or something like that. So, I think he's educated. But in this, it opens with the parents... reading a newspaper in which dad's photo's on the front. So he's like a pillar of the community. He's not just a doctor. He's a major figure in the health and welfare policies of the city.
He's an important appointee.
Yes.
To some kind of... Yeah, he's in City Hall.
Yes.
So in the town hall. And he's in charge of health.
Yes.
Health regulations.
Yes.
Yes. So, yeah, he's a person of significance.
Yes, so he's, but he's also, right off the bat, he's kind of an object of ridicule for the audience and some of the other characters who are, he's like, this picture of me in the paper looks ridiculous. Yeah. And then one of the CP's friends comes in, he's like, oh, my dad said something about your picture in the paper, and he's like, and then he has to, like, cut himself off, because it was
of course.
Like,
and of course, he said, and it's funny, when he looks at that picture of himself in the paper, he's falsely modest. He says, oh, look at this terrible picture of me in the paper.
Yes, yes.
Can you believe it? Pause. And then he says, I don't really care about any of this. I don't care about publicity. I'm only interested in the work I'm doing. And then there's a beat. And then he says to his wife, maybe I should get some more pictures taken.
Yeah.
And as you said, it's funny.
Yeah. So, meanwhile, Skippy's upstairs asleep. And they call up the stairs to him and say, it's time, you got to get up and come down. And he's like, yeah, I'm getting dressed, I'm doing all this stuff. But he's actually got his eyes closed, he's lying in bed.
Well, our POV is down in the dining room.
Yeah.
We can see his mum and dad calling up to him. And they say, you know, his mum says, you know, like dad says, come on, Skippy's got to come down for breakfast already. You know, you spoil him. Let's call him down already. And she's like, Skippy, come on, come down.
Yeah.
And he goes, yes, mum, I'm just trying to decide which shirt to wear.
Yeah.
Should I wear this one? The one I was wearing yesterday? I think it's still clean enough. Or should I wear this other one? This clean one, which I just got out of the cupboard. And then, so that's what we hear. And then we cut up to his room.
Yeah.
And he's in bed.
He's in bed with his eyes closed.
And he's just sort of raising one hand.
Yes.
And then the other.
Yes.
As he's saying these lines.
Yeah. Finally, he gets out of bed, goes to the bathroom. He's complaining the whole time out loud about all the crap he has to do to get ready. Why does he have to live this life?
Yeah.
He brushes his hair. He puts a bit of water on a comb and brushes his hair to prove that he's brushed his hair.
Yes.
And then he's about to go down. He realizes he's forgotten to brush his teeth. And you think, okay, he's going to rush back and brush his teeth. No, he wets his toothbrush and puts it back in the holder.
Yes.
Very funny. And then his dad's coming up the stairs and he slides down butt first on the banister, which I thought, he was such a kid in this movie. It's very comic booky, and his outfit is very comic booky.
It's straight from the comic
book. Now I have to say,
no one else wears an outfit like it in the film, really.
Like the first 10-15 minutes I was laughing, but I was like, this isn't like the comic, because he's, where are the fences and where's the grass? And then he goes out and then he's walking through his neighborhood, and I think his dad's, they're in a nice neighborhood, so there's these nice bushes. I'm like, this isn't like the comic. But then, as we learn at the breakfast table, there's a hilarious speech where he talks about how he went to the other side of the tracks, and then he tries to talk his way out of it. But when he goes to the other side, I'm like, oh, this is Skippy. We get the fences and the dirt and stuff. When he goes to Shantytown. So then it really picked up for me. But
I, on the other hand, found this very like the comics.
Okay.
So, although maybe not visually with the picket fence, but I found the way Skippy's behaving and the things he's saying.
Yes.
To me, that felt straight out of the comic.
Yeah.
Like, because even Skippy's, in the comic, Skippy's mischievous.
Yeah.
He's always, the Tom Sawyer comparison is very apt, because it feels very much like Tom Sawyer.
Yeah.
You know, he's hoodwinking people, but he's got a heart of gold. So, you know, like, he's, that scene with his mum, like that's the same character that I was reading in those comics.
Right.
He's putting one over on his mum so that he can get a few more extra minutes sleep.
Yeah.
But the minute his dad yells up the stairs, he hauls himself out of bed. Okay. Respect the patriarchy, sure.
But, well, I think there's more to that, which we'll get to when we get to the end of the movie.
Sure.
But I did love
his kind of melancholy ramblings as he's in the bathroom also feels straight out of the strips.
Yes.
Because he's got almost, combined with his mischievousness, there's a world weariness often.
Yeah.
Isn't there in the in the strips? Absolutely. So I was watching the first 5 minutes, I'm like, this feels, sure it doesn't look like the strip, but I'm like, this feels exactly like the character that I was reading.
But I think it's amped up, because the strip would, you get 12 panels to get to the one gag at the end about whatever.
Yeah.
Whereas this is like a mile a minute. It's just coming so fast. Like every line has got something, and he switches tack so often. Like that whole thing about how, his dad doesn't want him to go to Shantytown, like, you know, we are important people in this town. What if you had friends like that? What if my friend was the garbage man? He says, the garbage man's son has a white goat. Oh, it's such a great line. just completely had nothing to do with anything.
Yes, and he's like, so Shantytown, it's literally the other side of the tracks.
Yes. Yeah.
So his mum and dad don't like him going to the other side of the tracks. Because on the other side of the on his side of the train tracks, it's the gentry. They have white picket fences, sure enough. And their names emblazoned on their gates.
Yes.
But over the other side of the tracks, it's a shanty town. Yep. It's like a Hooverville. So this is in the Great Depression.
Yep.
So I imagine that this is topical. It's a poor kind of shanty town, no amenities, no facilities, just bits of wood and tin.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. Yeah,
corrugated iron.
Yeah,
things like that.
Yeah.
And the father, in his role as Commissioner of Health, or yeah, something along those lines, yeah. It has some sort of, casts a long shadow over the town.
Yeah, so Skippy had a friend over there, he makes a new friend, Suki, this boy Suki, through an elaborate. Suki was trying to steal some wood.
Well, Skippy likes going to Shantytown.
Yeah.
As he would, because it's full of
life.
And
all the kids know him.
Yeah, yeah. It's compared to the kind of stratified, stultified, environment.
We meet two of his friends on his side of the tracks, who are Eloise and can't remember the name of the other kid, but it's like a brother and sister, I think.
Yes.
But she's written this poem about her dead dog, which she comes in and recites.
She's a really funny character.
She's really, and he's kind of like, he seems like he's 40 years old or something, this other kid.
Yes.
He's Skippy's friend.
He talks about how he's so high strung.
He's high strung. He said, what was that, I'm nervous and high strung?
Yes.
Is what he described it as.
He won't get in fights.
Yes.
He tries to stay clean.
Yeah, he tries to get out of fights.
But he as well, the kids love... They like the other side of the tracks because it's full of life.
Yes, yes.
And it's a real... It's a kid's perspective. Of course kids gonna like this. This is where the action is.
Yeah, yeah.
They get in scrapes and they play games. That's where their clubhouse is. It's called the Owl Club.
Yes, there are black kids on the other side of the tracks, which we don't see on the gentrified side.
Correct.
So he goes over, he makes a new friend, Suki, through a chain of hilarious events. He starts a fight with him and then gets him out of a fight when somebody else attacks him. The kid he doesn't like, the enemy of his enemy or whatever, attacks him. He's like,
One thing, I think this is an invention for the film. Skippy has a really well-developed sense of fair play.
Yes.
Not really present in the comics, but he absolutely has a heart of gold, kind of like Tom Sawyer, right?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, yeah, yeah. 100%.
And it's his defining characteristics, perhaps even more than his mischievous nature, is that he's always looking out for the underdog.
Yeah.
He's always sticking up for his friends.
Yeah.
And when he plays pranks, it's always for the greater good. Yes. It's always in defense of someone vulnerable, like, or to raise money for a valuable cause.
Well, okay, so he learns from Suki that Shantytown has been condemned.
Yes.
And it's going to be shut down. They're going to tear it down. And he has to move away somewhere.
Yeah.
And Skippy's like, why is all that happening? And he's like, oh, the guy at City Hall who's in charge of the stuff said there's germs in here or whatever, and they got to tear it down.
Yeah.
And somebody else tells him that it's his dad that is the one that ordered this. And Skippy doesn't believe it. He's like, my dad wouldn't do that. And then it becomes clear that it is his dad that is doing it.
Because he asks his dad himself.
Yes,
and his dad gives him this spiel... Like, about sociological juxtaposition.
Yes. Oh, there's a great moment here. I have to mention, there's a moment where he's listening to his parents. His dad's getting dressed for this dinner or speech or something.
Yes.
Skippy goes into their bedroom, climbs on their bed, and he's lying on his back, and he takes his pet turtle out and sits it on his knee, lets the turtle walk around on his knee while he's on his back with his legs in the air. And it was such a great kid moment. Like... Almost ad-libbed. I'm sure it wasn't, but it just feels like, whoa, what a natural weird... And I also think his parents don't know about the turtle. I don't think his dad would allow that turtle that he keeps in a can and carries around his pocket. But he doesn't turn around. He doesn't see it. He never sees the turtle in that moment.
Right.
So it's a great little thing where he's like doing this thing in the background where his dad's too distracted to notice it. Anyway, so yes, as you're saying. Yeah.
No, you're right. He finds out that his father is responsible for having Shantytown...
Yes.
So he goes and talks to his father. Surely it's not true, Dad.
Yeah.
And his dad says, well, son, you know, it is true, you know.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons is, and he has, the father at this point has this theory advanced early on where he says, I shouldn't be friends with the Dust Man.
Yes.
Right? Which is that, how would you put it? Is it a segregationist message? No, that's too politically loaded. But the idea that there should be a separation between the classes.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
That Skippy belongs to a certain class, and these kids and people belong to another class, and they shouldn't mix, or they'll be found wanting in some fundamental
way. Well, he seems to be very germ-obsessed as well. So I don't think it is class, but it's only class because that class has germs, and our class is cleaner. And
I don't think it's chicken
and egg. I think the germs are first for him.
Sure, but it's probably the language of germs is being used to reinforce a class divide.
Sure, yes.
So it's the new language of hygiene, which is still, even in the 1930s, is still kind of...
Yeah.
Still a fairly new one.
Yeah.
Is being used to reinforce this idea that the classes should remain separate.
Yes.
And that Skippy is a good scion of the bourgeoisie.
Yeah.
Shouldn't be over mixing with the working class.
Yes. Now, at this point in the movie, I'm like, okay, this is going to be like Three Stooges where they have to save the orphanage. Now these kids are going to have to save Shantytown sometime. Somehow. But...
A good guess.
But
a damn
then there's
good
a
guess.
Then there's a distraction because we've learned earlier that Suki has this pet dog that doesn't have a license. And one of the guys in Shantytown is this guy, is the dog catcher.
He's the dog catcher.
This guy, this mean
Mr.
guy
Nubbins.
With the kid that they hate the most in Shantytown. I have to say there's nothing where very close to the comics here where there's a lot of arguing over 5 cents or 3 cents or 2 cents. Because this kid, the dog catcher's kid, buys a 5 cent ice cream and they're trying to get this ice cream off this kid.
Yeah.
They play this trick on him to get the ice cream, so he takes Skippy's top. He ends up breaking a windshield on his own dad's car.
Yep.
Skippy gets blamed for it. Then at some stage, the dog gets taken away by the dog catcher. So they go to the pound.
I think it's implied that the jerk kid dobs them in because he's riding in the dog catcher's... Oh,
right.
He is the dog catcher's son.
He is the dog catcher's son.
But he's riding in the...
Yeah, yeah.
The dog catcher's dog-catching van.
Yes.
As they drive away with his dog, Penny.
Yes.
So he has this... He has a, like, a mongrel.
Yeah.
It's really mangy.
Well, there's a funny speech about
being
a thoroughbred. I have to say, I loved the... It's Suki's mom. I loved all the parent-child relationships in the movie. Even with the dad, who is kind of figured as the bad, quote-unquote bad guy of the movie. I loved all those relationships.
Yeah. There's only a handful of characters, and they're all pretty well developed.
Yes.
Suki's mom's a bit of a paragon of virtue. But
yes.
Everyone else is pretty well developed, I think.
Yeah.
And although Mr. Nubbins, the dog catcher, is an out-and-out kind of villain.
Sure, yeah.
But yes, Suki has a little... As a dog, Penny, it's mangy, it's mongrel, he wants it to be... They say thoroughbred, by which we... I suppose we would say purebred these days. And, as you said, there's a hilarious speech where he said, well, all of the various parts that make up Penny were purebreds.
Yeah.
So he has this bit of a purebred in him,
yeah.
And this bit of a purebred, and this bit of a purebred. So I guess that kind of makes him the king of purebreds.
Yeah.
It's like, I guess you're right. The way these kids deliver these, I mean, they kind of yell their lines.
Yeah.
But they're clever, and especially Jackie Cooper, I think, really.
Yeah.
He absolutely has a talent. I can see why he was nominated.
There's an amazing shot out of the back of the dog truck, the dog van, when it's driving away, which surprised me as well.
There aren't a lot of imaginative. It's very workmanlike, I think, this film, a lot of the time. It's certainly technically competent.
Well, I'm not so sure. Well, I guess it's technically competent. I would say beyond, because there's a lot of follow shots, like dolly shots in the outdoors, where they're following the kids as they're walking up the street.
There aren't a lot of... That shot stood out, I agree.
Yeah.
Where we're driving away in the car, and we can see the dogs... It's over the dog's head, and we can see Suki and... Skippy running
through
the bars of it. But those kinds of shots are few and far between.
Yep.
A lot of the time it's shot in a kind of very straightforward manner, as you said.
Especially for the interiors, sure.
Where we're literally seeing through the fourth wall and it never changes perspective.
Yes.
Yeah. But, I mean... But to say that, the film, I think it... You can watch it now and it doesn't look... unprofessional. It doesn't look of its time. Like, it holds up.
Yeah.
By what I mean, when I say workmanlike, I mean, it doesn't make any errors.
Right.
So they don't have steady cams and things like that, and sometimes the camera wobbles, so you can tell that you're watching a film from the 1930s. But in a lot of other respects, it's technically very, very proficient.
Yeah.
And you can absolutely watch it now and not be taken out of the film.
Yes.
By the limitations of the technology of the period.
Yes. And even, maybe unrelated to that, even the language, which I found difficult to follow in the comic strip, is I didn't have any trouble, only with the sound recording, maybe, if I ever had trouble with the audio, but the dialogue was very sharp.
Absolutely. Yeah. It feels modern.
Yeah. So the dog, so because the dog gets captured, in order to free the dog, they have a certain number of days. They have like 3 days.
3 days.
And they need to get $3 for the dog license. So suddenly, what I thought was going to be a movie about them trying to save Shantytown is now about trying to save the dog.
Yes.
So now we get all these schemes that these kids cook up. It's almost a montage, not quite, where they're like, okay, we're going to sell some bottles.
First they break open his piggy bank. And there's whole shenanigans with that. Oh, yeah.
Whole thing where he has to get his... He's been saving money for a bike. He's got to sneak the piggy bank out while his parents don't see him do it. Then they got to find a way to get it open. There's a great sequence, actually, where a car drives over it, misses, doesn't crush it, and they're like, ah.
That's
then
really it does funny. Crush it.
And then
twice. It happens twice. Two cars go back
then
and forth.
Then finally it breaks open, but then the other kids show up and they have to hide the
Skippy
money.
Skippy says, I could steer better than that when it doesn't run over the...
Yes. Yeah.
That's really funny.
Yeah, that's a great line.
It breaks open. Then they have a whole thing where they have to pretend, they have to convince Eloise and her brother to play a game of hide and seek because they don't want them to know...
Yes.
That they have $3 because they know as soon as they know they have $3, they'll ask for it. Because,
like in the comics, anytime anyone has 3 cents, it's like a feeding
frenzy. They're on them like flies.
All the other kids are like.
Because that's what happens when they know that the dog catcher's son has a nickel still.
Yes.
He bought an ice cream cone with one nickel, he still has a spare nickel.
Yeah.
And even though they hate him, they're on him.
Yeah.
Like white on rice. Yeah. Yeah. They trying to wheedle his nickel out of him. If I had a nickel, I'd give it to you.
Yeah.
God, the way they yell their lines.
Yeah. Then they hold a crazy ass talent show.
Oh man, it's so good.
It's just a complete disaster. But there's so much funny stuff, like the ticket taking. Suki is the one taking tickets. And sometimes...
He sells the tickets, and then he checks the tickets.
He sells the tickets, but sometimes he'll just take collateral instead of money. And he puts it in the money box. He rips off a date from a date calendar as a ticket, hands it, then walks over 2 steps, takes the ticket from the person, and then goes back over
and
to the ticket
selling
and
them
sells
again.
Another one.
Yeah, very
wild.
Funny. Very funny.
And then everything in the show is a disaster, including a poetry recital by the girl, Eloise.
Eloise, they get her to pay...
Yes.
She runs up to them. They don't like her, as boys never like girls, right? So that's a real cliche. So they don't like her. She knows their secret handshake. Oh, it's a secret yodel, right?
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
She knows their secret yodel, and she yodels it constantly.
Yeah.
And then she marches in, and, I've got a dollar, I've got a dollar, she says.
Yeah.
And this is when they're desperately trying to raise the $3 to save Penny, and you can see... Skippy's eyes light up and he starts on one of those whole Tom Sawyer-esque spiels where he tries to convince her.
He's got some other actress lined up, I guess.
Well, it's like painting the fence. He tries to convince her that she wants to give him the dollar.
Yeah.
And he does it. You know, it's because she really, really loves reciting poetry, as you mentioned, going right back to the very first scene. Yep. And
poetry.
She ends up paying him a dollar to recite poetry at their talent show.
Yes.
They raised $2.70.
Total.
Oh, I forgot to mention. They break the bank and it had $3 in it, but Mr. Nubbins, the cruel dog catcher...
Yes, took the money for the broken windshield.
Takes the $3 but doesn't surrender the dog because he says they have to pay for his windshield first because they broke his windshield before he caught the dog and you have to take things as they come.
Yeah.
And it's so unjust.
Yes.
Because it wasn't even them that... Never mind that that logic doesn't make sense, but it wasn't even them that broke the windshield.
Yeah.
And I love the way Skippy, the character, Skippy, as played by Jackie Cooper, is always meeting setbacks.
Yes.
And he really is talented because... the way he meets these setbacks, he never goes to an extreme of emotion. He doesn't become angry, or he doesn't become sad. He just looks slightly crestfallen.
Yeah.
As though, of course.
Of course. Yeah. Yeah.
It's
absolutely.
It's really good.
Yeah. So now they've got $2.70.
Yes.
They're 30 cents
They go to
short.
City Hall to ask Skip's dad for money.
Yes.
But
they get turned away.
They knock on the door.
Of the big meeting room, the big council room.
But Skippy's dad won't come out. Dr. Skinner won't come out. The man that they meet asked him and said, sorry, Skippy, it'll just have to wait till dinner. or until you see your father this evening. Skippy's like, well, that's... And then he goes, hey, I've got an idea. What if we just give Mr. Nubbins everything we've got? Because we're almost got $3. We just give him what we've got, and we'll tell him we'll get the 30 cents to him tomorrow. That's how we paid for our piano.
Yeah.
And they're like, yeah, you're... You know, Suki's like, you're right, Skippy, let's go do that.
Yeah.
And then they run off, and they get there. He's like, I've got a proposition for you, Mr. Nubbins. Here is $2.70, and we'll get the rest to you just as soon as we can. And Mr. Nubbins says, well, there's no need for that, because I shot that dog.
Yeah. He shot the dog. They killed the dog. I could not believe it. I was shocked, much as the kids were shocked.
They just look like... This is... Yeah. They just look absolutely stunned.
Yeah. Nubbins is like, well, that's the law.
Yeah.
And then we...
I don't like the law. That, yeah, this is great.
Then we pan over to the poster on the wall, which is a long statute about dogs.
It says rules and regulations. It's about 20
paragraphs. It's very blurry because Skippy's through the tears. It's very blurry, but then it slowly becomes clear as he pans down the huge poster of the regulations, and at the bottom is his father's signature.
Yeah.
That was like, whoa, holy shit. Okay.
It's serious business, and he just looks...
Yeah.
He just looks... He's crying. So this is...
Oh my God, Suki goes home and tells his mother...
Well, there's a whole scene here.
Yeah.
This scene is excruciating.
Yeah.
It feels about a year long.
Yeah.
They're walking down the street,
yeah,
and Suki's silent, just walking beside... He's got tears running. He's got tears running down his face, and he's silent. And Skippy's walking along beside him, also in tears, occasionally getting choked up, and just trying over and over to cheer him up.
Yeah,
look, we've got this $2.70. Let's take it to the candy shop. I bet we could buy everything in there. Suki just doesn't answer.
Yeah.
It goes on for so long.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, I can see why this guy run Best Director, because it's... I said excruciating. Like, this scene is so intense.
Yeah.
You know, he's like, here's my tortoise, you know. I got... And also, he's trying to be so upbeat. He never says, I'm so sorry, Suki. Jesus, I'm sorry. Have my turtle instead. He's like... Oh, I have a cricket now as well, so I don't think I even have room for my tortoise anymore, so why don't you take him? And he just tries, and he does pratfalls. It's an astonishing scene.
Yeah.
It's really emotional.
Yeah.
And none of it works, and Suki throws himself into his mother's arms and says, Penny's dead.
They said they killed Penny, and now I want to die too.
Jesus. You can tell this is pre-haze code, can't you? Because of all this talk of death.
Oh, yeah.
And then Skippy goes home as well, and...
he's an absolute wreck as well.
And this absolute...
Dad tries to figure out what's wrong with him, tries to comfort him, he can't. And actually, this goes back to what I was about to say before about the patriarchy, is I think it's beyond that. I think it's... There's this father-son relationship where the kid is 8, 9 years old, and the dad is a giant. As your dad is when you're 8 or 9 years old. He's an absolute giant. There's never even a consideration. It's never like Skippy's like, when he finds out his dad is tearing down Chaney, it's never like Skippy's like, well, I'm going to find a way to change my dad's mind. It's beyond human capability. Right. It cannot be. Literally, you cannot fight City Hall.
Right. You're right. It's a big part of it. And I think it's very well done, because Skippy never looks at his father as someone that he needs to... that he needs to hoodwink into doing his bidding to trick or... Well, he does he does a lot of misdirection.
No, you can see, if this movie was made in 1987, it would have ended with the kids showing up in court to fight to save Shantytown.
No. Whereas, you're right. And that nothing that... Instead, Skippy really, really loves his dad.
Yes.
Worships the ground he works on.
Yes, absolutely.
It's so different from the way, as you say, the way it was portrayed in children's movies of our time in the 80s when children held their parents in contempt in those movies.
Yeah.
And see them as contemptuous figures that they need to circumvent at all possible times. Skippy loves his dad.
Yeah.
And sure, this is probably a reflection of the attitudes towards the paterfamilias of the time. But He loves his dad. He repeats verbatim whatever he says.
Yes. Yes.
So when his dad tells him about sociological juxtaposition as to why the shantytown can't exist next to uptown.
Yeah.
He goes and repeats it to the other kids.
Yeah.
Except humorously mangled. Yeah. You know. It's the sociological juxtaposition.
Yes. Yeah.
And that's why we can't do it. And then when he asks his dad for money and his dad won't give it to him, he says to Suki, well, the problem is that my dad's just supporting so many people. He's supporting so many poor people that he doesn't have any money left over to support. And so what happens, of course, is that Skippy collapses on his bed and gives the absolute powerhouse of a scene where he's weeping and praying to God to bring Penny back from the dead, to make everything right, to do something. And the dad comes in and is like, what's wrong? And he can't. He can't bring himself to tell him what's wrong. And the dad just says, I've got to go out now. And the mum's like, where are you going? You haven't had your dinner. Doesn't matter. She's like, haven't you got a meeting that you got to need to go to? Not as important as this. Off he goes.
Yeah.
And what happens is that he goes out and makes everything right overnight.
Yes.
Partly. He buys a bike for Skippy, which Skippy has always wanted to cheer him up. He buys a new dog for Suki.
Yeah.
He overturns the ordinance that says shantytown's going to be demolished.
Yes. This is all off screen.
I think, yes, it is all off screen. And it feels a bit deus ex machina.
Yes.
But it's also, I think it's fine because it's also about the mystery of adults to children.
I agree. But also, how did he know? How did he know about Suki and the dog? How did he find out any of that stuff?
Skippy was mumbling stuff about a dog.
I don't know if he mumbled enough to reveal.
Sure, it didn't. It doesn't matter. Because
also, the thing I like about it, and the thing I like about his dad being, I like that they didn't go to a court case at the end. The reason I like it is because it's very much the kid's perspective.
Yes,
it is. The kid's
absolutely
world.
Yeah,
it's the kid's adults are kind of, they're there. They're your loving parents, and they're there. And whenever he wants to cuddle from his mom, she's there. All that stuff is there, but that's, they're in their own universe with their own rules, and
you're right.
There's no, in that universe, kids don't go into where grown-ups go, into court rooms and fight this stuff, or go into city, go into, you never see the inside of that council room in City Hall. They're not allowed in.
No.
They can just go into the lobby. You're that's right. The limit of their,
I completely agree,
their purview.
I felt exactly the same way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's why that works, and I think, I couldn't understand how he fixed it. How did he know where Suki lived?
It doesn't matter.
How did he know he never met Suki? How did he know that was the kid that lost the dog? How did he piece together this huge puzzle?
There's a few more moments. Skippy trades his brand new bike for a dog from Eloise so that he can take the dog to Suki, and then when he gets there, of course, he finds out that Suki already has the dog that his dad has got for him. Yeah. He doesn't know that at that point. And once again, he just takes it in stride.
Yes.
He's just like, of course this happened.
Yeah.
Of course I gave away my brand new bike and you already have a dog.
Yes.
Then his dad comes out from where he's meeting with the mum. That's when it's found out that the shantytown doesn't have to move. His dad's overturned it.
They're going to clean out the germs instead of tearing down shantytown somehow.
That's all the explanation we get. Yeah. Whatever. He's just realized that these people have a right to live where they want. Yeah. And whatever. It doesn't matter how he came to it because, as you said, he's a mysterious parent.
It's the land of the gods.
Like an act of God. Yeah. But then also, he's also come around. He has been influenced by the kids because he's come around and he lightens up.
Yes.
He takes him for a stroll. He shows him how to throw a stone. Yeah. And, of course, he breaks the windshield.
Throw a rock. For the dogs to fetch. Which they could not get the dog. They could not get Penny to fetch a stick. They can't get these two dogs to fetch a stick. This is the final moment.
He smashes the windshield of Mr. Nubbins.
Yeah.
Mr. Nubbins comes out. Mr. Nubbins hates Dr. Cooper. Because he sees him as a busybody.
Yeah, from the beginning.
And, of course, and then Dr. Cooper's transformation to the ultimate parent culminates in him decking Mr. Nubbins.
Yeah.
To show that he can scrap just as well as Skippy, his son, can. And then essentially it's roll credits. One thing's interesting about this film is that there's no music.
Right, I didn't even register that.
So speaking of the technical, like, technically it seems very modern, but one way in which it's obviously different from a modern film is that there's no music whatsoever.
Right.
There's music over the opening credits and music over the closing credits, and that's it.
Yeah.
I mean, in other respects, you can hear the dialogue fine. It has sound effects. They're not obtrusive.
Yeah.
They're just part of the background.
Yeah.
No music. And I wonder if it's... Now, I couldn't find any evidence of this, but I wonder if it's recent enough that they're still playing it...
It's possible.
...on actually. A piano in the theater as they're watching it.
I don't know if they'd be playing it on piano, but maybe they just weren't at the... They were... The level of technology was where they couldn't really add the music on.
Well, but as you know, the silent films would usually have a live
music. Yes, of course, yeah.
I wonder if they're still... They're doing both. I couldn't say. I'm sure the information's out there.
Yeah.
Something to check in a future week.
Yeah.
But, I think this movie absolutely holds up. Absolutely holds up. Yeah. Because it's both of its time and timeless.
Yes.
I think you can watch it and see these... cool historical details, like, of course, the clothes they're wearing.
Yeah.
The fact that it's kind of a Depression-era tale, because you have the obvious poverty and the kind of interventionism by government, although, of course, it's presumably municipal government in the film, but this is at a time when, Percy Crosby himself was railing against federal intervention in his affairs.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why Percy Crosby didn't like the film, because of the message that government knew what was good for you, perhaps. Because he certainly was anti-federal. He was probably a states' rights kind of guy.
It's weird. It's the strip is so mild.
Well, the bits we read, who knows what happened.
I
find it really infuriating that I couldn't find out more of what exactly these political stances were, other than that he opposed FDR's New Deal and didn't like particularly the bill to increase the number of justices on the Supreme Court.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and he especially didn't like taxation, because he fought a very long battle with the IRS.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, so in that sense it's of its time, but in the other hand you have these kind of... It doesn't feel out of time. It feels like something you could almost watch now. It has some great, great kind of timeless themes. The inner life of children, the idea that children have an inner life, that's important to them, and that's separate from the world of adults.
Yep.
The idea that the poor have dignity and, that they're people, although they don't have agency in this, because they have to be saved by Dr. Cooper, but they do have dignity, and it's important for Dr. Cooper to realize that they're people and that class is less important than a common humanity. And that whole thing, empathy, because Skippy is a very empathetic character, which is, I don't think he is in the comic necessarily, but in the film,
right.
Absolutely, yes, absolutely, deeply empathetic.
Is there anything else? I just want to mention that there might have been another... There might have been another nomination here that I'm just thinking because there were four screenwriters.
Okay.
Joseph Mankiewicz is probably the most famous because he won a bunch of Academy Awards, not all for screenwriting. But it says here that Sam Mintz was nominated alongside Joseph Mankiewicz for Skippy. So, but I didn't see the information elsewhere about Skippy being nominated for a screenplay. But anyway. All right, anything else we...
Oh, I want to talk a little bit about trivia. Do we have time?
Yeah, trivia, absolutely. There's lots of time.
Oh, my God. We're doing okay. Yeah, we're doing great.
We're really good.
Jackie Cooper wrote an autobiography later in life.
Okay.
It's called Please Don't Shoot My Dog.
Wow.
Now, a lot of people these days will have heard of Skippy because of a particular story that circulates around its production.
Okay.
And that is that the director... Jackie Cooper's uncle.
Norman Taurog. Yeah.
Threatened to shoot Jackie Cooper's dog.
Okay.
In order to get those...
Those tears
out of him.
Okay.
Right? So, after this film... This is the film that made Jackie Cooper. So, he'd been in films before this, like Our Gang.
Yeah.
But after this, he was a big Hollywood star. He was called America's Kid.
Okay.
Yeah. And as well as, he was, as I said, he was known on set as Bucket of Tears because he had to have a crying scene.
Right.
Whenever he appeared. When you
went and saw... Well, how did he turn it on in the other movies?
Well, that's... Well, exactly. That's the thing. That's the story.
Okay.
So, they knew that he has three big crying scenes in this film, right?
Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. So, for the first one... So, first of all, you know, like, they harangue him and kind of, like, ask, tell him he has to cry. You have to cry in his autobiography. So I actually downloaded a copy of it. I got it off, I requested it off Internet Archive and actually read it as prep. And, you know, like, he talks about the kind of, the sense of responsibility and pressure he felt like he was under a lot of the time. Because people would say things like, your mum's sick, you need to, this is your job, you need to act.
Yeah.
And if you don't act and you don't perform your job, your mum's gonna have to go out and work, so you need to work. So he felt this pressure, but he couldn't bring himself to cry. Instead, he would get angry, apparently. So what the first trick that Norman Taurog did was apparently tell him that he was going to sack him.
Okay.
He yells at him, you're a ham, you're a lousy ham actor.
Uh-huh.
This is kids 8 years old all the time. He's going to he's going to sack him.
Yeah.
And he actually went to the trouble, apparently, of dressing up Robert Coogan, who plays Suki, as Skippy in the spare costume.
Whoa. Wow.
And telling him he's going to sack him and he's going to have him play the role. Wow. And that was enough to bring on the tears.
Okay, wow.
Apparently. But that trick's been used once, it can't be used again.
Okay.
So it's time to... It's the second time. And now, like, Jackie Cooper feels under terrible pressure. He knows he has to cry. But... He also knows that they're going to try and trick him into crying, and he's aware of it.
Right.
So, it says, I might actually read a little bit from it. You know, I worked hard as I could, but I knew there were two more big scenes coming up where I would have to cry. By then I understood how they had tricked me the first time, and I was sure they were going to try and trick me again. So I was determined when the time came, I would cry by myself. Of course, when the time came, I couldn't. Dry-eyed, I faced their wrath. I knew I was being very, very bad by not crying, hurting my mother's health, disappointing my grandmother, making my Uncle Norma unhappy, but I simply could not bring forth a tear. So, he had a dog on set. He had a pet dog that someone had given. So, Norman, the director, said he was going to take the dog away. I asked him where he was going to take my dog. He said to the dog pound. He said if I finished work in time, i.e. if I cried for him, I could maybe get to the pound before they put my dog away. If I didn't, well, that was too bad.
Whoa! Okay.
But he's literally in a film where this is the plot of the film.
Yes.
So he says, I smelled a rat. This was the trick they were going to use to get me to cry. I didn't dare risk a smile, but inwardly I congratulated myself for being too smart for them. This one wasn't going to work. I stood there and watched as my grandmother took the dog, untied him and carried him out. She said she was going to put him in the car and drive to the pound. I heard him yelp. I knew Grandmum had pinched him to make him do that. Again, I got angry. There were no tears. Another tantrum. I was so mad, I threw anything I could get my hands on. Norman said, okay, this is the end. If I didn't stop that immediately, he said, he'd have the policeman, there was always a security guard on set, shoot my dog. I said, apparently, he didn't have the guts. Norman nodded to the security guard. I saw him draw the gun out of the holster.
Whoa.
I watched him as he went in the same direction my grandmother had gone with my dog. The set was deathly still. I couldn't see them. Then I heard a single shot.
Oh, no. Oh, my God.
It echoed for a moment.
Whoa.
Then total silence. I could visualize my dog bloody from that one awful shot. I began sobbing so hysterically that it was almost too much for the scene. Norman had to quiet me down by saying that perhaps my dog had survived the shot.
Oh my God.
That if I hurried and calmed down a little and did the scene the way he wanted, we would go and see if my dog was still alive.
Wow.
So I did the scene as best I could. Later, of course, I found my dog totally unharmed. And Norman and my grandmother and the security guard grinned at each other, proud of the little trick they had pulled.
Wow. Well, I will say, initially when I... sort of watching it, and knew that he was nominated for Best Actor. I was like, well, he's just a kid playing a kid. Why'd he get nominated for this? I mean, he's precocious, but is that not?
He's very precocious, isn't he?
Yeah. But when the tears started, those scenes, for sure, it was like, yeah. This... Well, had to force that out of him in some way. Give that kid a gold medal.
So the story goes, after this, he gets the knack of crying on cue after this, understandably. Right. Because...
Yes, because otherwise he'll do...
Because otherwise God only knows what will happen. Yep. He says in his biography that his mum explained it to him. Okay. She told him he needed to empathise with the character he was playing. Imagine what they were going through, what they were feeling.
Yep.
Once he was able to do that, then he was able to cry on cue. Make of that story what you will. It puts his acting at the centre. It praises his mum, who he loved, denigrates his uncle, who he hated.
Yeah.
But certainly he didn't have any... He continued... Every film he appeared in from then on, he would always have a crying scene.
Yeah.
But that's terrible.
Yeah.
Can you imagine? Yeah. Jesus Christ. All right. Cartoon, yeah. Comic, yeah or no?
Nay, you can't read it anyway. Good luck finding it. Super expensive hardcovers, I guess. Art's kind of sweet, but it, again, it's outclassed by other stuff. The strip's been outclassed.
I agree. It's sort of like Friday Foster in that certainly it's a comic of significance.
Yes.
And if you have an historical interest, I guess, in the history of comics, you could seek it out, but to read it for pleasure?
Also, we read 50 in a row, which is not how these things... If you're reading one a week, maybe it would be
more. It would have been palatable. A throwaway gag that when it's just over and over.
And it would have been maybe a bit better, but also I think with...
Excellent.
I think Friday is more historically important, because if you read... You can read five of these and say, okay, I get it. Like, I see the point of it or the influence it had. I don't think you really need to read a ton of them, although... You know, obviously Charles Schultz read all of them and was in love with it, whatever.
If you're interested in the antecedents of comic strips essentially as they exist today.
Yeah, I mean, even, I mean...
Everything from Hagar the Horrible to Peanuts to...
Yeah, something like Foxtrot, especially any of the kids ones, like Foxtrot or all those ones.
This is where it all started, really.
Really hard to imagine without...
And I'd never heard of it. Most people, I think, haven't.
I'd only heard of it in the context of the peanut butter and that there was some loss. That's all. I'd never read it.
Amazing.
The movie, yay for me.
Also yay. Okay. Yeah, for all the reasons we've discussed.
Yes. Adaptation.
I'm going to say yay.
Yeah, I'm going to say yay too.
Do you want to go first?
Yeah, I think especially once they got to Shantytown, I was like, okay, this looks like the strip. It's almost, I feel like maybe unfairly that the strip was based on Our Gang. So I feel like making a movie of it, which is like an Our Gang movie, is exactly what it was meant. It's what the strip wanted to be. It's almost like this is what the strip was trying to do, but in comics form. So in a sense, it's kind of, I think it's better. It's funnier, obviously.
I think this one absolutely checks the box for brilliant adaptation in my book because it's better.
Yeah.
The gags land better.
Yes.
When they're being delivered.
They're too fast to keep up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And also, Skippy is fleshed out in the movie. Like, he has, like, such a character in the film. Yeah. He has this heart of God. Obviously, there's an obvious debt to Tom Sawyer, I suppose. But he's fleshed out. He's such an empathetic, heroic almost.
Yes.
Character.
Yes.
In the way he looks out for the downtrodden.
Yes. Oh, you know, he doesn't save Shantytown.
He does. No.
He doesn't save the dog. It's really interesting.
Mm.
He's limited to what an 8-year-old can do. An 8-year-old cannot save the town or the dog.
This is a sophisticated portrayal, and it's an absolute improvement on the kind of two-dimensional character in the strips.
Yeah.
So I think in every way this is a successful adaptation.
Yeah. Okay, so I think we can talk about what we're going to do next week.
Ah, yes.
Okay, so next week we have suddenly decided we're going to do Dale Messick's Brenda Starr Reporter.
So this is also an old comic. Right?
50s, yeah, I'm going to say she started.
I think maybe even earlier. I think it might have begun in the 1940s.
Okay.
So, of course, Skippy began in 1923, but it ended in the 1940s.
Yeah.
So we have a certain parallel there.
Yes. But the movie is from What did I say? It was 87 or 89, something right. like that.
And apparently has Jeffrey Tambor in it.
Jeffrey Tambor, Brooke Shields, and what's his face? James Bond. And he was in Flash Gordon.
Timothy Dalton.
Timothy Dalton.
Brilliant. Brilliant.
Apparently the movie really sucks. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, I can't wait.